Johnson Chukwu, the Group Managing Director at Carry Asset Management, is joining me also from Lagos. Good morning to you, Mr. Chukwu from Abuja. How are you today?
We are very good. Good morning, Nancy.
Good morning. Are you still working from home?
No, I'm in the office.
Okay. Earlier on, I was speaking with Michael Famaroti, who is the chief economist of Stairs Data. We're looking at the impact of COVID-19 on businesses. Let me speak to you, or let me just ask my question. The first question to you will be, what do you think is facing medium and big businesses at this time? Do you think that they can outmaneuver uncertainty and still maintain solvency?
And that is some will, but some will not. It depends on the quality of their leadership and how dynamic they are, the structure of their balance sheet. When I talk of dynamic leadership, right, you have to be able to do your scenario planning, look at if this happens, what will I do? And then you have to be proactive as a leader. You don't have to wait until this happens to you. You have to plan and take measures to implement your plans. Then as it relates to the balance sheet of some companies, companies with very low balance sheets or companies that are highly leveraged will struggle in the next couple of years, and they may not survive the economic downturn. The simple reason is that if your balance sheet is highly leveraged, you have to have interest payment obligations. You have obligations that you have to meet, irrespective of whether your income is strong or not. And we know that incomes are not going to be strong in the next couple of months and possibly in the next few years. So a lot will depend on your balance sheet and the quality of your management.
Now, when you're talking about quality of management, that's where leadership comes into being. Perhaps those leaders should have certain qualities at this time. And these are leaders that did not anticipate, or these are people that did not even anticipate a COVID-19 pandemic just even 3 months ago here in Nigeria. How do you think that, or what critical decisions, give me like 1, 2, 3, what critical decisions should they take to turn this complexity into a meaningful change, and a change that will last for a while? Earlier on, I did talk about, when I was speaking with Michael, what we saw from Access Bank just a few days ago, how about we were coming out to speak, I think, to his employees, but we saw the backlash that happened. He's a leader in the banking sector. So what kind of decisions should leaders take at this point that they will not even have a backlash?
Okay, I think the first decision any leader should take is you have to look at your sources of revenue, which is the top line. You have to ask yourself, this source of revenue, is it sustainable? Should I diversify my revenue sources? And my approach should be that everybody who is any business operator who is operating in a third world economy should ensure that you have multiple income sources. So you need to ask a leader, you need to ask yourself, how will my line of business be impacted on by this COVID-19 induced crisis? Am I still going to be able to sell my products to my consumers? Then you have to look at your channel of delivering service to your consumers. How do I optimize my channel of delivery of services or products so that I minimize my costs? In a period of low sales or low revenue, one of the focus of management should be on cost optimization or cost containment. You have to look at what are those discretionary costs I'm currently carrying that I need to disembark or to eliminate. So the second aspect is your cost. Cost leadership will never go out of fashion in a period where you have economic crisis. The third portion is that you have to look at the deployment of your resources. You have to, particularly your human capital deployment, which you mentioned, Herbert Wimbe's position. My position is that you, at a period when you are not growing your revenue, you can't continue to carry free riders. I'm not saying you should go on massive retrenchment, but there may be some people in your employment who are really contributing nothing. But because your revenue has been quite strong, you have continued to carry them. So at periods like this, you need to offload your disembark free riders. First thing is that look at your revenue sources. Look at how sustainable they are. Diversify your revenue sources as much as you can. Two, look at your channel of delivery of services. It's going to be a transformation of channel of delivery of services or products. People are going to go virtual. You have to make sure that you automate your processes and therefore reduce the level of human interface as well as minimize your cost. And then eliminate all deployment, long deployment of resources. And then finally, you also look at your capital deployment. free up resources where they are suboptimal. Are they investments you made that are not generating revenue? Then it's time to sell them, even after you have all the jobs and you've got your lots. And then look at which other areas should I deploy resources. At a time of low prospect of revenue growth, it's not a time when you go on expansion. So you need to cut down on your capital investment and rather free up resources that are invested in sectors that are no longer vibrant or may not survive the COVID-19-induced economic crisis.
Mr. Chukwu, businesses is all about experience, you know. Businesses are about experience. For you, you are selling an experience. So either you are selling an experience or you are buying an experience at this point. With the COVID-19, I realize that our experiences have changed. For example, you know, the way customers, even human beings, general human beings, the way customers, clients have been, you know, reacting to this COVID-19 has definitely changed. Citizens, employees. How will this affect the way that businesses design, communicate, and build, as well as run experiences that people need and want? I hope you understand what I'm saying. Let me just give an example. For the last 1 month or so, for example, and I know some women will also be in my own category, some of us have not even been close to a hairdressing salon, let's put it that way, as minute as it is. And those businesses are even part of the small businesses I mentioned earlier, or micro businesses. Some of us, you know, we just go for the essentials. The essentials, the food, the non-alcoholic drinks like water and all of that. So if you are selling that kind of experience, selling that kind of service, how do you now begin to design, communicate, run experiences that people will need, then eventually want, because we are in the zone of need now?
Okay, Nancy, like I mentioned earlier, you have to look at how do I distribute my services or products. That's the core of among the transformation I expect leaders to take. Take, for instance, the issue of hairdressers, and you did mention. One of the things I expect hairdressers to do is that they now need to program or schedule their customers. I'll give you an instance of what happened this morning. My wife needs to go and pick something from a shopping mall, and they had agreed she should come by 12, so they gave her a specific time when to come. So if they schedule their customers that way, they are not going to have crowd in those places like the hairdresser. But most importantly, they called her this morning and told her, please, when you are coming, don't forget to bring your face mask. But because if you don't come with your face mask, we won't allow you to come. The shopping center will not even allow you to come in. But if they even allow you to come in, you're going to head straight to go and buy a face mask before you can come into our shop. So you need to do that. So you can't come into our shop without your face mask. So that's the first thing. But let's look at other value chains. A lot of people are going to use virtual electronic payment system to carry out their transactions. And let me give you a classical example. Let's assume you have a mom and pop shop within your neighborhood. And then people around your neighborhood are the ones that buy from you. You can give them your number because they know you, and they will call in to order for what they want. Once they order for what they want, they can pay you electronically. They can transfer money using the internet system to transfer money to you. And then you package their purchases and then have it delivered to their doorsteps, just the way you used to deliver newspapers at doorsteps of individuals. So I expect people to adopt new channels of delivering their services or products. That same thing will apply to major shopping malls. People are going to have personalized services where they don't need to interact with so many people when they come around, if they might be physically there. But in other instances, you are going to see situations where customers will stay at home. Now we're seeing people who are aggregating. I can tell you what is happening in Lagos, where I live. There are some people who have actually transformed their business, that are aggregators. What they do is that some comfortable people that don't want to go to a place like Kate to go and buy food items because of the fear they could get infected. So they have aggregators, and these aggregators have contact numbers of those who sell those food items, tomato, potato, yam, and what have you, in places like Kate. And those who will deliver these food items to the aggregators' homes or warehouses, they will package and deliver to individual homes. They just package, they have people who will go to their warehouses, package them, and deliver. People place orders and say, I need 2 kilos of food. this quantity of pepper and all those things. And they will deliver to their individual homes. So those women like you, and they don't need to go out to go and get those products. All they just need is place their orders and have them delivered. So I believe every business operator that wants to survive this period, we need to look at your channel of delivery and go virtual. You need to modernize your channel of delivery. It's very critical. And then for those that have to, that their business requires human interface, they need to schedule their customers so that they don't need to come and meet a crowd because that will turn off some people from coming there.
Mm. Especially now that we have community transmission, you know, but that's an issue for another day. Let's take a look at Nigerians that are finding themselves out of work right now or out of their jobs. Many Nigerians are worried about money as we speak, perhaps through no fault of their own, for, let me say, a second time in 4 years. What I mean a second time in 4 years, because it will really have to take, I don't know the kind of actions we'll put in place this year for the Nigerian economy not to go into a recession. So that's why I'm saying second time in 4 years, or is it 5 years, 2016 and now, between 4 years, that we will be in this kind of, you know, stress. Do you think that the federal government, do you think that the government at all tiers have been able to figure out a way to alleviate this business stress on all of us? For example, the media industry too will be facing a lot of stress. If you see, for example, AIT, we've been doing COVID-19 watch, all the advertisement spend has dropped significantly and all of that, but we still have to come on air to educate and inform Nigerians. So do you think that the government has figured out a way holistically to alleviate this business stress on all of us?
That's a doubt if the government has done that. I believe the government has a long way to go to articulate clearly how it wants to intervene to support the private sector, to support businesses so that we have minimal level of business failures. Because really, business failures lead to further increase in unemployment. Like in other countries, they have, to a large extent, prepared or they have mechanisms to intervene in the affairs of businesses. I mean, for America to come out of the global financial crisis of the 2008-2009, the US government gave out economic financial support to several companies that helped them restore to good health. And those companies eventually paid back those loans when the economic situation improved. If you go to places like England, the UK government is paying 80% of the wage bill of companies so that they don't, because if you leave that to the company, they will immediately sack those workers. And if you try to carry those burdens as companies, they may go on. So they are paying the wage bill of companies. I know Western countries are really planning on how to support the visual sectors in their country so that they won't go flat. But I'm not seeing clearly what the government wants to do other than what the Monetary Policy Authority has done. We know the Monetary Policy Authority has come up with 50 billion naira to support small and medium-scale enterprises and families. So I think beyond the monetary policies, the fiscal policy has been largely dormant when it comes to how to intervene to solve, to cushion the effect of the current crisis on businesses. You did mention the media industry. Yeah, of course, clearly, at periods of slow economic situations, you expect that the number of adverts will go down. Most people will not want that. It becomes a discretionary expense. And such companies, most companies will not want to incur such discretionary expense. But like you said, you guys have been providing social service to the community in terms of the nation by advertising the mitigations of how people should avoid COVID-19 infection. So the government, that means you're actually burning airtime for the government or for the public, or for the interest of the public. And it may be necessary for the government to support because the media has also some of the sectors you consider as essential. Even during the lockdown, media workers like you are still allowed to move around. So you see newsmen and newswomen, of course, you guys only use newsmen, going about around the country and being at difficult periods like this. And it simply means the media has to largely keep all their employees, unlike some other sector that can ask a reasonable percentage of their employees to stay at home and avoid working or minimize their wage bill. So there are sectors, aviation sector, the hospitality industry, sectors like yours, and that is the media sector, that are badly affected. And I think they will need some level of government support. Unfortunately, we've not seen that. We've not heard anything. The government, maybe I hope they are still in the drawing board, but it's getting too late. We should come out and assure them how the government wants to intervene.
Yes, just to buttress what you're saying, I think I heard the Minister of Information, Lai Mohammed, say, I think they are waiving 2 months licensing fees for media companies. And when I saw that, I was like, what? That is not enough, because I was expecting a more a robust plan, especially for now. But there's also the argument that if government also intervenes for media companies, won't they, this bias come into all of that? But I think I'll be looking at that in another edition of the program. We just have a few minutes to go. You mentioned the $50 billion by the central bank. That's through the monetary authority. Do you think that's enough with the scope of unemployment that we come out of this? And the B part of the question is, we have an unemployment rate of 23%. What unprecedented scale are you looking at moving forward?
Okay, Nancy, the $50 billion, well, they say that anything is better than nothing. It might be like a drop in the ocean, because what will happen there, a lot of these small businesses would have completely exhausted, consumed their capital from the lockdown. Because what you can realize is that the small business operators who are living on, who are trading with 50,000 naira, 100,000 naira, 3,000 naira, in a period of 1 month or 5 weeks lockdown we saw in Lagos, Abuja, and Ogun, they would have completely lived on those capital and exhausted them. So they need to be recapitalized, like we say. And if you know that they account for about 48% of our economic activities in the country, so the sheer number of the small business enterprises, the woman who is selling a crown by the roadside, the man who is hawking bread, the one who is selling handkerchief, the small business operator in Yaba or in K2 or in the day market in Yaba or in Onitsha, they are so much many that 50 billion will be a drop in the ocean. Mm. But it's good that something is being done. I'm hoping that the government, the fiscal authority, will take it from there. And these are actually things that should be coming from the fiscal authority, not necessarily monetary authorities. I think it's because of the vacuum we saw in the fiscal space that the monetary authority is stepping in to play the role of fiscal authorities. Okay. But in other countries, the US government came up with the figure that they wanted to give to support their economies, and it should come from the fiscal authorities.
Okay, final question for you, and I'll need you to answer it in 30 seconds. Do you think that all those analyses and business contingency plans are still at the mercy of the evolution of the pandemic? Because all those things we are saying, all this grammar, Turenchi, we've been speaking, is still at the mercy of the evolution of this pandemic and how far it can go and how far we can curtail the spread.
Nancy, by now, we should have some estimation of the level of infection. Lagos State Government came and said that they expect up to 1,000 infections in Lagos. Countries like the U.S. are projecting on a daily basis the level of infection and possible death in their country. We should have that. And if you have that, we should plan with such figures. Unfortunately, like I said, we've seen a lot of setback at the levels we should expect those strategic thinking to take place.
Okay. Thank you very much, Mr. Chukwu. Thank you as always. Thank you as always. Have a lovely day. All right, I've been speaking with Johnson Chukwu, who is the